scientists are calling for boycotts on for-profit publishers.
Science journals don't pay their authors, they don't pay their reviewers, the public pays for the content, the science itself.
We need to give academics the freedom to start doing what they want, when they want, without these large institutional changes putting pressure on them. That needs to change immediately.
Academia is broken. Today's scientists depend on a handful of multi-billion dollar companies. With one decision, these companies can catapult a scientist's career to new heights or bring down whole branches of research. But it wasn't always like this. This is the story of one man who impacted modern science like no one else. One man dreaming of ultimate experiments and young scientists challenging the status quo. This is the story of the day when academia was broken. The ripple effect is, quote, a situation in which one event produces effects, which spread and produce further effects. Ripple effects are mostly known from economics. For example, when one bank defaults, it can trigger a domino effect leading to more and more bank failures. Ripple effects often seem unpredictable in the beginning, but sometimes someone predicts seemingly unforeseen consequences right from the start and perfectly describes how a whole branch of society will develop. Not many people have been described in so many ways as Robert Maxwell. Self-made entrepreneur, a war hero, fraudster, and spy. Robert Maxwell was born in 1923 in Czechoslovakia. In the wake of the Second World War, Maxwell fled to France and then to the United Kingdom, where he joined the British Army. During this time, he also met his wife and went on to have 9 children, including Ghislaine Maxwell, who will be affiliated with Jeffrey Epstein some decades later. Yeah, fun fact. When the Second World War ended, Robert Maxwell served as an intelligence officer in Berlin. Colleagues would later report that he always had a great desire to be a billionaire, and he already knew how he could do that. After the Second World War ended, science started to enter a period of unprecedented growth. Governments worldwide pledged to allocate increasing amounts of public funds to research, guided by a common vision, to nurture subjects of their own choice, in the manner dictated by the curiosity for the exploration of the unknown. Sounds great, but there was one issue. With all these new funds, numerous projects were launched. Once a study was finished, scientists need to publish them, and that was challenging. You see, publishing at the time worked like this. Universities or group of scientists launched a small publishing company. These organizations were not made for profit and were largely underfunded. It often took months to release new findings. Maxwell realized that with all this new money in research and science, this issue would only deepen in the years to come. So he devised a plan, and in the process would change science forever. Step 1. Enter the publishing business. When Maxwell realized how profitable scientific publishing could become, he used his connections to join a German publishing company. After gaining first experience in the field, he purchased Butterworth Springer, a small publisher. At that point, Butterworth Springer was nearly bankrupt, but Maxwell saw a golden opportunity. With his own company, Maxwell could publish the works of scientists and make them accessible to the world, and in the process make money. The more he publishes, the more profit he could make. Sounds great! The newly founded company needed to gain a reputation though, and it needed to happen fast. Step 2. The Great Maxwell. Maxwell joined forces with Paul Rosbert, another entrepreneur in the same company. In 1955, Maxwell and Rosbert attended the Geneva Conference on Peaceful Uses of Atomic Energy. He rented a small office close to the conference. Then he attended every seminar and talked to as many people as possible. His premise? Exclusive contract for every scientist. Do you have new findings? You don't have to wait. We publish them immediately. And so the printing began. Maxwell and Rosbert started to launch the first issues of the magazines. And they already were quite successful. But that wasn't enough. Maxwell wanted more. Whenever he attended a conference, he rented a bigger mansion, hosted more lavish parties, and handed out expensive gifts to scientists. And in this process, he made a name for himself. His company promised to provide the best service while looking after the needs of scientists. Within a short period of time, Maxwell received and published more and more studies, and his company became one of the big players in the field. All stars were aligning for Maxwell. He has conquered territory with seemingly endless dreams of money. His customers, scientists desperate to get a results printed, were satisfied. Others would stop here, but not Maxwell. He wanted more. Now Maxwell could enter the final phase of his plan. Step 3. Expands. Luckily for Maxwell, the system in place guaranteed him a second stream of revenue. Once studies are published, he owned their copyright. In order to access the articles published by Maxwell, universities have to buy them or subscribe to his journal. In this way, Maxwell could even earn more money. And there was even a loophole. Every time a new journal is made, a university has to buy a new subscription to read its contents. In other words, the more journals Maxwell creates, the more money universities will pay. There are some formal requirements for launching new journals, but Maxwell easily fulfills them with his publishing company. So the main work was really just to find new names for the journals. According to Peter Ashby, a former vice president at Maxwell's company, Maxwell would often simply combine phrases he loved to use. His favorite being the International Journal of, and he also followed trends. When Maxwell saw the rising popularity of computers, he founded journals starting with the title Computers and... The genius behind Maxwell's business model is that journals do not compete with each other given the abundance of scientists wanting to publish with him. By 1959, he was publishing 40 different journals. 6 years later, he would publish 150. Rousseau, who has worked with Maxwell for some years now, disagreed with his tactics, and soon later, the two parted ways. By the end of the 1960s, Maxwell had it all. His company has completely reshaped the way science worked, and there were only two things that threatened him. Number one, government funding for research stopped. Not really a concern. As long as research continues, there were reasons to fund it, and there was a constant stream of new research topics. In the 1960s, Kennedy launched the space program. In the 1970s, Nixon declared the war on cancer, and later, AIDS surfaced. And then there was a second threat. Scientists stopped publishing in his journals. Maxwell treated his customers very well and looked after their needs. It was a win-win situation. But then things took a turn in a small office in 1974. Ben Lewin was a scientist at the National Institute of Health. Lewin had a vision. He wanted to launch a scientific journal. Unlike other journals that mostly covered short articles, he had something else in mind. Big. Scientific blockbusters. With that idea in mind, Lewin founded Cell, a scientific journal that would reshape science in the years to come. Cell was different than anything people have seen so far. Articles often contained hundreds of experiments all combined to one great study, and the scientific community loved it. Since Lewin only accepted big discoveries, it suddenly became prestige where to publish. You have an article in Lewin's journal? Wow, you must be an expert! But this seemingly innocent way of publishing might have set something in motion that irreversibly damaged science. Now that prestige became important, two numbers were developed that measured the success of journals and scientists. The impact factor is calculated for this formula here, and it defines how often an article is cited in a specific journal, on average. The higher the impact factor of a journal, the more probable the chances of finding international recognition. Similarly, the age index described the performance of scientists. Suddenly both journals and scientists experienced a new form of pressure. Journals have to become highly selective to keep their impact factor in a certain range. And scientists must have a high age index to get job positions and funding. And that creates a fatal problem. Suddenly scientists needed to tailor their research towards trending topics to stay relevant. And this completely undermined the idea of free exploration of the unknown, which has been established as the main goal of science. An established scientist raised concern. Peter Higgs, who has received the Nobel Prize in 2013, stated that "It's difficult to imagine how I would have ever have enough peace and quiet in the present sort of climate to do what it did in 1964. Also, Peter J. Radke's initial work on how cells sense oxygen was rejected by a major publisher, and Yoshinori Ozumi only had limited resources when he started working on autophagy. They would later win the Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine in 2019 or 2016. Even Katalin Carrico could not secure funding for her research on mRNA technology, the same research which just has been awarded the Nobel Prize for Physiology or Medicine. Of course, we've seen massive advances in some important research fields, but we also do not know what breakthroughs we have missed over the years. In his later years, Maxwell would focus on other projects. He became a member of the British Parliament from 1964 to 1970, acquired the Mirror Group newspapers, and became the chairman of Oxford United Football Club. His ending though was abrupt. In 1991, Maxwell fell from his boat and drowned. A few weeks later, significant discrepancies in his company's finances came to light. Just like significant discrepancies in his daughter's approach to human rights and trafficking would be uncovered some decades later. Still, Maxwell's business model became the status quo. Scientists pay publishers for the work to get printed, and universities pay to read the same articles. Scientists also review scientific works for free. As a result, the biggest publishing houses have a profit margin higher than Apple, Google, or Amazon, translating to billions and billions of dollars a year. The general consensus in the scientific community is that it's completely fine to pay for publishing articles. We might disagree in the amounts you have to pay, but in the end, you are provided a service. It is also fine for many scientists to review articles for free. In the end, they are the experts in the field and they can judge the work the best. But many disagree with the amounts you have to pay in order to read articles. Not all universities can afford the millions of dollars you have to pay for subscriptions, and that in the end hurts international collaboration. The main point of all of these efforts is to make knowledge freely accessible for everyone. This is just one issue scientists face nowadays, but it's the first step. But something was on the horizon, or should I say someone? Alexander Albakian was born in 1988 in Kazakhstan. While obtaining a bachelor's in computer science at the Kazakh National Technical University, she realized that she couldn't access many publications, as the university didn't have the resources to subscribe to all major journals. During a short work-related trip to Freiburg, Germany, and Georgia, United States, she observed a stark contrast. Scientists in these locations had nearly unrestricted access to most publications. When she moved back to Kazakhstan, she became extremely frustrated. How is it fair that universities do not have access to scientific publications if they do not have enough resources? So she set a goal: break the system. She started requesting passwords for university accounts from researchers all around the world. Then she created a website, Sci-Hub. The idea is simple. Using the password she has obtained, she could store the publications on her servers. Whenever someone wants to read these articles, they can simply find them on her website. Today, over 87 million works are deposited in Sci-Hub. You might now ask, is this illegal? Yes, absolutely. This form of sharing is illegal as it breaks copyright law. Over the years, Albakian has faced multiple lawsuits. In the US, she faces charges of copyright infringement up to $15 million, the maximum allowable amounts. And there are also lawsuits in other countries, such as India, but they are still ongoing. Still, she argues that, quote, science should belong to scientists and not the publishers. In the past year, some institutions have started to take action. Given that universities often pay several million dollars a year for one subscription bundle, some argue that research should be at least publicly available. It all began at UC Berkeley in 2019. The administrators decided to terminate a contract with one of the major publishers. The ongoing negotiations led to an agreement that all of the articles will be openly accessible for everyone. The Max Planck Society in Germany, together with over 300 universities in Germany and Sweden, followed suit. And just some weeks ago, it was announced that also for the Max Planck Society, published research will be accessible for everyone to read. Individual groups of scientists have also launched their own journals, where their articles are freely accessible. The most successful so far is PLOS, which has seen remarkable growth over the last years. From one businessman who saw a golden opportunity, to a researcher who dreamed of scientific blockbusters, and one student who was frustrated with the system. The way science operates has undergone profound changes in recent decades. Some of them are good. Publishers have enabled rapid progress in scientific advancements. But maybe we've gone too far. Scientists depend on publishing extraordinary studies that might hinder scientific creativity in the long run. The high and higher costs that universities must bear to access research articles pose a significant obstacle to the free exchange of ideas. It will be interesting to see how all of this will develop in the years to come. Although published research is mostly robust and truthful, there are some cases of scientific fraud. If you're interested in that, you might like these videos.